Hello and welcome to the legal session we have on privacy, know-how protection, and unfortunately not open source, because when I had a talk 1 year back, I had the idea of combining different legal aspects that might be interesting for app development. Data protection, know-how protection, how do I protect my know-how within a pitch, and especially open source development. For know-how protection, I have a colleague of mine, Stefan, the handsome blonde guy in front, who will be taking up the stage after me, and a third guy, Philippe, he falls sick today, therefore we have no open source excuse for that. We're going to have 20 minutes about data protection, and then 20 minutes on know-how protection. After that, we're going to have a little time for questions, so please save the questions until the end. Then let's go. First of all, Stefan and me, we are both lawyers working for CMS, an international law firm, because a lot of you will not know us. I have a short slide on what CMS is about and where are we actually based. As you can see, we are mostly European and based. We are origin in Germany and the United Kingdom, and now expanding into mostly North and South America. And let's see where it takes us from there. We are over 5,000 lawyers actually worldwide, so that makes us one of the biggest law firms worldwide. We are both working in the Leipzig and in the Berlin offices. Stefan specialized in intellectual property law, and I do mostly IT and data protection within my day. And that's one of the first topics I want to talk to you about, is data protection. We're going to have 20 minutes, so I'm just going to give you a very, very short overview on what is actually the discussion within data protection. You all heard of GDPR. What is GDPR all about, and how can I be compliant within a firm or within a project with the GDPR, and in order not to violate data protection regulations? The first question is, where is this need for data protection actually coming from? We have data regulations like back from the 70s of the last centuries within Germany. The European Data Act was from the 90s, but actually until 5 or 10 years back, no one was really talking about data protection on a wide scale. Two points actually led to the situation we are in now, that actually everybody is talking about data protection and how to be compliant with data protection rules. The first one is, this is a symbol for development within the last 10 years. It's called digitalization, it's the connectivity, it's everything personal about the internet and everything personal about apps. We are having the FIFA World Cup right now, and there are a lot of famous apps for the FIFA World Cup going around. But only 12 years back, just to give you a short insight on how rapidly technology has changed within the last 10 years, Android was released 10 years back, I think, 2008. And for the FIFA World Cup 2006, we didn't have any apps because the iPhone was released in 2007. We didn't have an app store back then. This was only 10 years until we reached the point where we are now, where we're talking about AI, we're talking about big data, we are talking about data lakes and data mining. That's a development from 10 years, which is an eternity within technology, but only a day within legal developments. That's something you have to realize. Legal development is very, very slow. We are slow thinkers, we are not as fast as you, we are just trying to catch up. The second point that put data protection back on the menu was Edward Snowden and his revelations in 2013, because it showed everybody what is possible with personal data, what is possible in order to track us, in order to see how we are behaving on the internet and what is actually going on. So those two points led to these numbers from 2016. Over 90% of consumers are actually concerned with data protection issues, and a lot of them are restricting their use because they are afraid of how their personal data is being used. This has to be kept in mind, because it's not only that there is some legal issues and we want to be compliant with the regulations in order that we don't get fined. No, data protection is actually kind of a business case. And if you look around, there are a lot of apps within development actually protecting privacy, or there are apps especially made for privacy, for ghostery and stuff like that. in order to be more private when using electronic devices. And this is one thing. Data protection is on the map, and it needs to be applied not only for reasons of law and to be compliant with the regulations, but in order to have a business case. And actually, the European Union heard the call for data protection back in 2011. And in 2011, the process for the legislation of GDPR, you know, the General Data Protection Regulation, was started. And in 2016, actually, the GDPR was finished and everybody knew what was coming. Nonetheless, when it was time, May this year, that the GDPR was getting into force, everybody seemed relatively surprised, actually. But we know it is coming, now it is here. Problem is, actually, is the question for you is the GDPR an issue for my company, or is the GDPR an issue for my app that I'm developing or that I'm processing? One simple question: are you processing, storing, or doing anything with personal data? A lot of people are saying from the first glance, no, we are not doing, we are only using pseudonymized data, we are only using caller IDs or something like that. The problem is, within legal terms, personal data can be a lot of things. These are just examples actually decided by courts or by authorities. And if you look at a first name, that's clear that it's that personal data. Problem is more like analytics, IP addresses, phone name, biometrical data, caller IDs, IMSE IDs. All those little numbers that can identify a phone, that can identify an application or a device, have to be considered as personal data. So if you are processing those numbers, if you are processing those informations, and actually every app will process those informations because every app will need to process those informations, you have an issue with GDPR, and you have an issue because you are using personal data. So when we have now decided that, okay, I have an issue with GDPR, what do I have to do now? What is actually comprised by GDPR? The thing is, not much is actually new. And a lot of the issues we are now having with GDPR, I will talk about in a minute, we actually had for the last 20 years, but nobody cared about them. When we look at it first, the rights of the data subjects. What rights do say data subjects? Data subjects in that context means you and me as a user of an app. There is a right to transparent information and to transparent communication. You have to explain to the user how you will use the data, what are you doing with the data, which data are you actually storing, and which data are you deleting. These are rights to be informed. Much more relevant are those two data subjects have the right to access the data. They have an right to get information on what data you have stored and to delete or correct data. They have the right to restrict data use. They have the right to tell you, don't use the data you got from me in a certain way. You can store it in general, but you can't use it for marketing or you can't use it for advertising. But you may use it so that the app will function. And they have, that was something I talked about last year, it was the right to data portability. This was quite an issue back in the day, back 1 year ago, because everybody was thinking about, okay, how are we going to do this on a technical level? How are we going to process the right of a data subject to use, to move their data from one platform to another platform? Actually, it got a little tuned down within the last year. All you have to do is provide the data subject with the data you have, you have from them in a machine-readable format, so that he can maybe give it to another provider and maybe he can do something with it, but you're not actually within the position to offer a file format that he can easily transfer to another platform. That got a little bit turned down within the issue. What obligations do you as a company or as a data processor or as a data controller have? First of all, and that's for me the main thing within the GDPR, I tell that actually to all of my clients, Document, document, document. GDPR has become a compliance issue. You are, as a data processor or as a data controller, are obligated to prove that you are in compliance within the regulations. And you can only prove that you are in compliance with the regulations if you document what you are doing, how are you processing, when are you deleting the data. All these informations you need to document within a database management system or whatever you use. But somehow make it documentable what you are doing with personal data. This is one of the main issues. Second one is privacy by design and privacy by default. The GDPR says if you offer an application, you have to design it that it only uses the minimal data that is needed to use the application. And if you have different privacy settings, you actually have to provide as a default the most privacy sensitive settings. This has to be kept in mind if you are designing apps concerning data use or data storage. Two very relevant also obligations are data breach notifications. If you have a data breach, if you get hacked, if you get loss of data in any other way, you have 27 hours, 72 hours, sorry. You have 72 hours to inform the relevant data protection authorities that you have a data breach. That's not a lot of time. Therefore, you need to have a process in route so that everybody knows, okay, if we get hacked, if we have a data breach, everybody knows what to do in order to inform the relevant authorities. Data protection impact assessment is also something that will keep us up as lawyers and as developers within the next 2 or 3 years. Because the GDPR states that if you use personal data in a way that may generate a high risk for the data subject, means if you're processing health data, biometrical data, data about sexual preference or something like that, you have to assess the possible risk and consult with the relevant authorities actually before you put the process into place, before you release the app, not afterwards. Keep that in mind when you're thinking about such an app. Then you have to consult with the data protection authorities, and maybe you are obliged to install a data protection officer. The rule of thumb there is if more than 10 people are working within your company as developers, as personnel, you are obliged to appoint a data protection officer. That's just a rule of thumb. What do we do to be compliant with these regulations within an app development or as a company as a whole? We thought about 7 steps that are only just a minimum requirement, but it will give you an idea what to do. First of all, get a map. Get a map means get a map, draw a map on how personal data is used within your company or used within your app. Just actually do it. Just paint a map and see, okay, we got personal data from these persons, we are using that in that way, we are using that in that way, and the personal data is leaving the company at the end of the stream. When you have that map, read it and see if you can shorten the paths. Think about why do a certain person within the app development actually need access to the data? Can he use with anonymized data? Then use with anonymized data. Limit the data access within your company. Third part, know your way around the forest means think about the legal grounds you have for data processing. The GDPR gives a lot of legal grounds on how to process data or why you are allowed to process data. 3 are mostly relevant. First of all, you may get a consent from the user, which is not always the best way to do it because a consent is actually the user have to give it for you. You all know the problems with getting a consent. Second part is contractual needs. If you are with an app development and you are selling me an app, you need my personal name, you need my banking details in order to bill me, you need some personal data in order that I can use your app. For all this, you don't need a consent. Third part is if you have an interest, a legitimate interest in using my personal data, maybe for marketing, maybe in order to promote your app, you may also not need a consent, but you have to check how you can use data, as you have seen on the map before, on what legal grounds those data can be used. Fourth, if you need a consent, ask the user for it. Ask the user for a consent. Just do it. Second part, talk to the user. Inform the user on how you are using the personal data. Have a data privacy, have a privacy policy. Second, check the party guest. That means if you are transferring data to a third party, check why are we doing this? Do we really need to do this? Do we need a data processing agreement with the third party? What is the legal ground for transferring the data to a third party? And if you've done all that, write down it. Document everything you have. So if the data protection authorities are checking you, you have something you can say, okay, we have done all what we can. Here, when GDPR was coming, there were a lot of how not to do it reasons. And Laura received something very interesting from Yelp on how not to be transparent. I mean, we provide additional details about the information we receive about you and how we use it. These changes generally reflect new features and offerings. Can anybody tell me actually what they're doing with my data? I can't, no idea what they meant. Second, how not to do it and how not to get a consent. This is one of my favorites within GDPR. You all have received those thousands of emails to re-opt into some newsletters. Zoom did something very interesting. We want to stay in contact with you, blah, blah, blah. Yes, I'd like to opt in. Yes, but only one time per month. Yeah, you all see the problem with that one. This is also a privacy policy that shouldn't work. It means we have no idea what we are doing, but when we figure it out, we get back to you. Doesn't work also. So what can actually happen if it all goes wrong? It can happen quite a lot. Actually, one of the things that may hurt you the most is your app may get deleted from the store, which is maybe 1 year or two of development down the drain just because of a data protection issue. You may get administrative fines and personal damages, but actually those two are not as hurting actually as this one. And when it comes to data protection, I want to always end with this quote, because I think especially within the mobile tech industry, this is one of the main issues. This quote was actually by Tim Cook in 2017. And you all are in a very privileged situation as developers because you know what's going on with the personal data within the app. And we as users are giving you our information and our personal data and we trust you with it. That's a responsibility that you should embrace as we as lawyers embrace the responsibility for our clients. Thank you very much. This was it from me from the data protection for the first part. Now I give the stage to Stefan for know-how protection, especially within pitch situations. Thank you very much.
Okay, hello everyone, nice to meet you, and thanks for inviting me, thanks Christian for inviting me to this DroidCon event. You've been here last year. Christian and me, as already said, we are working door by door in the Leipzig and Berlin office of CMS. We are both working on IP and IT matters, and today our idea was to give you some information about data protection and know-how protection. Know-how protection, what is it about? What is know-how? It's about the protection of your innovations, your inventions, your ideas. Actually, it can be a lot. It can be all your patents and trademarks and designs you have registered already, but it can be a lot of more. It can be recipes of foods and beverage. It can be business plans. It can be all stats and figures of your company. So, So the know-how are basically trade secrets, so business informations, data and knowledge, business plans, informations about your clients, your suppliers, and partners. For example, Coca-Cola has a recipe on their cola, and it's one of the best kept secrets in the world. It's not stored in their IT, it's stored in a treasure and protected, and only a very few number of people have access to it. And all of these people have not left the company yet. So, as you know, you have patents, like all your rights you have registered, for example, but know-how could be a lot of more that cannot be registered. So, the you know how which cannot be registered, like patents or trademarks, has to be protected by reasonable steps under the circumstances to keep it secret. For example, patents, if you have a technical invention, you go to your patent lawyer, it's going to be applicated, and once it is it registered, you have all the rights of a patent. Know-how is a lot of is a little bit different. You have to act very carefully if you have business informations or other data and knowledge of your company, and be careful not to give it away too quickly and not talk about it too detailed. For example, if you're a startup and you go to a pitch, a lot of startups tend to present everything, all the details, all the business informations, and all the ideas and innovations because they're proud of it. And it is right to present it, but find the right measure not to disclose your know-how too quickly. So it's about, not to talk about too much in detail, and know what business informations have to keep as a secret. So how does it work? Do you know how, which is not already protected under patents, trademarks, and designs, have to be a part of reasonable steps to be protected? And these can be technical and organizational steps to protect. These are things in which you are the experts. You are IT experts, you are programmers, you are software developers, you know that. But there are also legal steps to protect, like employment contracts and contracts with suppliers, clients, and partners. So the technical steps are, I'm not telling you something new, are passwords, firewalls, limitation of access rights. For example, all your key assets, your know-how, which is very important, shouldn't be available to every single person in your company. There should be certain access rights for your assets, for your key know-how, for your key business information. So this should be clear. As well, you should classify all your know-how, all the know-how you have, into different classes and different secret steps. So there might be know-how which is not that important. So there could be a much higher access right. There could be much higher access rights to everyone than probably the Coca-Cola receipt, which is only available to a very few number of people. And part of the classification is a notation of the secret. So is it low secret, is it secret, is it top secret? So you should classify all the know-how you have, and which is not registered under patents or trademarks and whatsoever. Organizational steps are basically the documentation of all the reasonable steps to keep it secret. So which is not documented, it doesn't exist. And it's very important, I will come to this later, to give the court and the proceeding the burden of proof. So you have to show and you have to document what know-how or what trade secrets you have and which reasonable steps you are taking to keep it as a secret. Furthermore, it's about procedures and competences for the internal use of trade secrets. So there should be a plan of what are you doing with your know-how. There should be names of people who are competent for these know-hows. It shouldn't be everyone. It should be only the competent people dealing with very top secret know-how. And very simple, it's about workshops for employees on know-how protection, IT security and data protection and all this. Because the highest risk of a disclosure of know-how are not hackers or spies or something, it's actually the employee which is not aware, who is not aware about know-how protection, who maybe forgets his bag in the train, and in the bag there are papers, confidential papers, for example, or he's losing his USB stick in the train with very relevant data of your company. So it's even more important to do workshops with your employees, with your colleagues, to be aware that they are relevant data in your company. Because the general know-how is much more different than laws like patents and trademarks who are registered already. It's much easier to go to court and claim infringements of a patent because it's registered and it's there as a right. But for the know-how, you have to show the court that this is a trade secret and it's being a part of reasonable steps to be protected or kept as a secret. The legal part of the reasonable steps are divided in two branches. The first branch is the employment part, employment contracts. And employment contracts should contain non-competition clauses up to 2 years after the termination of the contract, which says your employee couldn't enter into your own business or couldn't create an own company with that know-how he has learned in your company. It should be also contain prohibitions to entice other colleagues. So mainly the people. These are the know-how holders. These are the people who invented something or who has learned a lot of know-how. And the biggest aim of a company should be to hold these people, these know-how holders, in the company. It's also about paying them more money, but you can also try to hold them on employment contracts like this. You should also have non-disclosure agreements in the contract. So employees who leave the company shouldn't tell about the secrets, shouldn't tell about know-how in your company. Actually, it's clear, but for some people it's not clear. So this should be in the contract. And it has the limitation in the knowledge he has learned lawfully and which he can use all the time. Like for example, all the skills I have learned in my law firm, I can use also if I go to another law firm. But I cannot take all the details about some mandates or internship information to other law firms. Very simple, but also useful, are IT and social media guidelines. It's also about not using your private iPhone with, using private iPhone with on social media stuff with relevant data on your company. It's clear, but some people are not very aware and share maybe informations on these social media channels. This is the legal part on the internship, like in between the company. But there are also important legal steps and contracts with suppliers, partners, clients, and so on. As I said, the example, the startup is looking for an investor and they are pitching, or maybe they are looking for a partner for a corporation. They maybe show all the details and show all the inventions and their know-how, and they want to convince the partner for a corporation, which they need. They need money, they need a partner. And then the negotiations are not very successfully. and there's no contract. And then a few weeks later, the startup, for example, finds the same product they have invented and developed in the stocks, but it's not their product, it's just a similar project of the former partner. And they haven't done anything, they haven't protected it as patent or something like that, and they didn't have a real protection or know-how, and there's probably nothing they can do. So the important thing is, when you're in negotiations with investors or partners, to have a non-disclosure agreement, and a non-disclosure agreement which says you cannot use that information you learn in our negotiations, for example. And to be effective, the non-disclosure agreement should contain contractual penalties, so a fine which has to be paid if the partner infringes that NDA. And the fine, the contractual penalty, should be just as high as it is not worth to breach it. So it should be an effective prevention for your negotiation partner not to use your details, not to use your information for own products or for own interests. And another special part of the know-how protection is the exclusion of reverse engineering. Under actual German law, it's not allowed to do that reverse engineering, which means buying a product lawfully, rebuild it, learn everything, and then build it up again as an own product. It's not allowed under German law, under other jurisdictions it is. But under the new European Union Know-How Schutz Directive, which is now being transformed into German law, it is lawful, it is legal, unless there are other contractual agreements. So in your future contracts with your suppliers, clients, partners, and so on, you should exclude the possibility of reverse engineering. Otherwise, the partner could rebuild it and do that reverse engineering lawfully. Well, what is lawful? Even under the European Union Know-How Directive, it is the independent discovery or creation. It's all honest commercial practices. It's the acquisition, use, and disclosure that is allowed under European or national law. It's the reverse engineering, and also the whistleblowing, which was a political aspect and which is only lawful under legitimate interests, so the freedom of media and stuff, but this is more a political topic. Unlawful is the acquisition of a trade secret carried out by unauthorized access to, appropriation of, or copying of any documents, materials, or files, and any other conduct contrary to honest commercial practices. And also unlawful is the use or the disclosure of these trade secrets who have been disclosed unlawfully. So what can you do in case of infringement and in case you have trade secrets who were part of reasonable steps to keep it secret? You have the possibility to claim injunctive reliefs, so the court prohibits these the infringer to use the knowledge, to use the know-how. You can claim damages and to prevent the damage or to number the damages, you have the right to receive information about the sales made by the infringement. So you can receive all the data about the suppliers, about the clients, about the sales and everything. But very important is it's up to you to give the proof. The claimant has the burden of proof, so you have to show the court that you have a trade secret and that it is a trade secret. So you have to show in detail that you have made reasonable steps to keep it secret. So you have to show you have, for example, all the technical aspects like firewall, passwords. You have different rights to access and all this. You have to show all your organizational steps, and you have to show all your legal steps to prevent disclosure of know-how. And very important is you have to document it. So if you have not documented it, it's not existing, and it will be very difficult to be successful in a proceeding in which you want to claim against the infringement. It's much more difficult than going with your patents and trademarks, but it's possible, and it's a nice alternative if you don't have a patent. If for example, the recipe, it's not open to a patent, it's not open for a design, not open for a trademark, but you want to protect it. So the know-how is an alternative, and it gives you also a lot more opportunities beside patents, trademarks, and so on. So we are ready.
And
last remarks. Well, as you have seen, data protection and know-how protection has not much to do with each other, but there's something in common. This is the technical and organizational steps you have to you do.
And the documentation.
And the documentation. So if you keep in mind that you have to document everything on these matters, you have learned the key issue.
The key issues. So we still have a few minutes left. Any questions? Okay.
Okay, it's working. So about GDPR.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, of course.
So I would have two questions. The first is, I think almost every Android developer are using Google.
Yeah.
For tracking, for analytics,
yeah,
and Firebase, and AdMobs, and so on.
Yeah.
That means, basically, we don't are using those data directly. We are using those data just to look how many people did what, and so on. So
yeah,
Google is using those data. And basically, what I learned, that we need to ask for every single thing by every user, but are the users really on that level that they understand what we are doing, and are we in the position to know what Google is really using, which data, how to overcome this problem?
That's one of the, I think, most legal hornet nests you can stick your finger in right now. Problem is, before the GDPR, we had within Germany or within European, as a general, different laws allowing pseudonymized or anonymized tracking or stuff like that. Now under GDPR, it's especially a German problem or a European problem. The German data protection authorities came to the conclusion that under GDPR, you have to ask the user for consent for every tracking, and they released a statement on that. Actually, there are no court decisions on that, and it's an unclear legal question. There are good arguments that you don't need a consent for every tracking mechanism you're using. You don't need a consent for Google Analytics. You don't need a consent for Google Fonts or for Firebase or something like that, because you have a legitimate interest for those measurements and for those tracking devices. But you are actually, when you are not getting a consent at the moment, you are taking the risk to that the data protection authority will open proceedings against you, and then we are in front of a court, and let's see what happens. The European Commission said, I think 2 weeks back, that we'll have clearance on this question within the next 2 years, because we're going to then have a court's decision. I can't tell you anymore, as the data protection authorities are saying you need a consent. There are good arguments that this is actually not lawful. This is not what the GDPR is actually asking you to do. But we have to wait for the first court's decision in order to have a little bit clearance on that. And the second part of the question concerning, do you need to explain what Google is doing? Last week, we had a decision of the European Court concerning Facebook fan pages. please have a look at this decision, because it states that if you are running a Facebook fan page, you are responsible for the data processing Facebook is doing, and you can't comply with that because no one has any idea. Actually, is anyone from Facebook here? Can anyone tell me what Facebook is doing with the data of the user? Because I don't even think Mark Zuckerberg doesn't know what he's doing actually with the data. And I know that Facebook is moving at the moment and is trying to get contracts in place in order that you can fill your information obligations to the user if you're running a Facebook fan page. This decision of the European Court can also be transferred to Amazon Alexa. It can be transferred to every Amazon and every platform infrastructure we are having right now. And yes, from the view of the European Court and from the view of the GDPR, you have to explain to the user what Facebook and Google and everyone else of every platform you're using is doing with the data. That's the legal aspect at the moment.
I've got another question, of course, it's about the GDPR. you've been talking about the documentation, and yeah. I wonder, how do I properly document that I deleted a user? Because in this moment, I would have to kind of make another document with his user data.
That's actually a very good question, and the thing we are recommending in this moment is that you actually document the deletion on without a name or just with a unique ID if you have a user. Just saying, okay, we deleted user number 14564X at this time, and this should be sufficient, because otherwise it wouldn't be possible. You would have to need a second database in which you have deleted the users, but that doesn't make sense because you already have another database, so I don't know any way else, and actually this has been working as far as we can tell.
So, I mean, this doesn't have to do much with engineering actually, but so like when people are roaming around the streets and taking photos, like, you know,
yeah.
How does that need to comply, like, you know, with an individual, and then you are also, like, you know, taking photos of somebody in the photo that potentially might actually care?
Two steps. First of all, the GDPR does not apply within personal use. Because when I'm on vacation and I'm taking pictures, GDPR doesn't apply because it's for my use. Another thing would be if I'm now taking out my phone and taking a picture and posting it on the website of my law firm, it would be a use that is compliant that would fall under the under the legislation of the GDPR. The problem is I have legal grounds to take this picture because I have an interest in taking it. Problem is I need to inform every one of you in order to that I've taken a picture from it and I will use it on a website, which is actually not possible. And there is a court decision from the Court of Cologne from last week saying if it's not possible to inform everyone, you don't have to use it. You don't have to do it. But taking a picture actually is a data protection issue. Yeah. Yeah, taking pictures has, with GDPR, become a more sensitive matter as it was before. Okay.
A last one. GDPR states that if we ask for consent, then the most protective point should be checked or not checked, but it should not be that way that the consent is not secure if the user says yes. Mm-hmm. So, and most of the developers and firms are using not checkboxes, because that is the question, if it is checked or not checked, and what does it mean? But they are using, as also in the screens before, just buttons, two or three of them, And one, also what the firm wants, or what the user wants, the one button is had highlighted.
Yeah.
That is not a pre-selection, but that is a design which says, please click me, not the other ones. Is it allowed? Is it just a, what's about that?
That depends on the actual design. Mostly those buttons are more flickery and saying click me, and that's okay. The problem, actually, the example I showed from Zoom, yes, but only one time per month, and that's not allowed. But you don't have to, the yes and no button don't have to be complete equal within the design.
I have a question. I'm not sure if it's the right format to ask, but I'll ask it anyway.
Yeah, go ahead.
So if I'm working on, let's say, an algorithm or something like that for my company, and then I'll leave the company and re-implement this algorithm with the knowledge I have, what's the state here of work? Can I get in trouble? Or
no, actually, it depends. Yeah? It depends. If the knowledge you have learned, you can of course use it in the new company where you're going, but it shouldn't be the details of the company itself. For example, if you have learned to program in your old company, of course you can use your knowledge to program websites or software or whatever in your new company, but you shouldn't. You cannot take informations of the old company, like insights, business insights, or figures and states to your new, and tell your new employer, well, look, my former employer, they are planning a merger or an acquisition next year, or they're planning that project, and we have to go now, and because this would be an internal business information of the old company, which is a secret, which is a trade secret, and you should not use this in your new company. Anyway, it happens. But you should not. But you can, of course, use your knowledge, like how you work and all the knowledge on your work, like programming, for example, or me doing law. This is something, of course, you can use in other companies, because this is your knowledge in your head. And you cannot take like materials, like papers and stuff. So everything which is in your head and which has to do with your knowledge, you can use, of course, in your new company, because otherwise it would... If it stops yourself from developing, it would stop your business, your own business. But yeah, this is the measure.
Okay. Thanks. And another question, if you don't mind.
Yeah, of course.
Which is not something that is concretely related to your talk, but I'm wondering if I'm writing some code, it's owned by the company, I guess, right? And what about code I write on a MacBook or on my laptop owned by the company, but in my spare time?
Yeah, if you write the code, it's usually protected by the copyright as a software, and usually it's the man who did it. But if you do it in your time as your work, where your employer says you as my employee, you develop a software, then it's the copyrights or the usage rights are owned by the company. But if it's something that has nothing to do with the direction of your employer, if it's a completely other software, something different, and you do it in your spare time when you have a day off, it's you are the owner of the copyright. But it has nothing to do with your work. If it's something completely different, So if it's the same software or the same idea or the same probably not. Then it has nothing to do if it's in your spare time or at work. But if it's a completely different thing. Different software, your own project, your own idea, which has nothing to do with your actual employer. You are the owner. You are the owner of the copyrights and of the usage rights.
And if I write that software on a PC owned by my company, does this have any effect or impact?
Well, it doesn't have any impact, but I think it's not allowed, because you should use your materials, your laptop at your work for the work for your employer.
Okay.
But it has. Usually, it has normally no effect on your rights, your own, if you are an own developer on your own idea and your own software, which has nothing to do with your work.
All right.
Yeah.
Thanks.
If you are an employee. Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Do we still have time for a question?
Well, because 1.5 minutes.
Okay, I'll make it quick. About GDPR again, about legitimate interests versus asking for consent. So if you're not sure, wouldn't it be business or legal-wise be wiser to not do the consent stuff, because asking for consent is more difficult because you have to track the consent state, make sure to properly save it, and the user also can revoke consent, so you have to take care of that.
From a business perspective, yes. From a legal perspective, I have to give the typical lawyer answer. It depends. It depends on how far away are we from the interest that may allow the use without a consent. Because the problem is, the data protection authorities, if you talk to them, for them, consent is the one big thing. That's the real cool issue. That's the cool stuff to do. And you have to have good arguments for your interest in order not to get a consent. But it can be a business decision, and we have clients that are actually doing this, that as they're saying, okay, for me as a business decision, I have arguments for an interest, so I go with that, and then the courts needs to tell me it doesn't work that way and I can change it at that point. From a business side, yes, it can be a valid decision.
Because I got the general vibe from the data protection agencies that they're actually going after companies which purposely violate the GDPR and not the ones who kind of, we try our best, we just didn't know better.
Yes, yes. Yeah. That's also, to whom we're talking? To which?
No, I just the news, I follow online because I don't know the details.
There are a few authorities that are talking off the record and are saying, okay, we know no one will be compliant. We know no one can be compliant, and we actually have no idea how to be compliant also. Therefore, we are first going after the ones we know that are violating, and if we check, and if we, what I talked before, if you can show us your documentation, and if you can show us that you have thought things through, that you have thought, okay, how can I do that? What are the arguments for my interest? They might tell you, okay, stop, but I think they won't fine you.
Thanks.
Okay. Then thank you and enjoy lunch.